amazed. It's wonderful to have someone like yourself out there doing this. On average, how many calls would you get in a year from people that are, who just need, who are slightly going off the deep end? They're not sure about what's going on in their house, and they ask you to come and check it out. How many calls like that would you get in a year?
Most of them come in
Most of them
via
come in
email,
via email, but or how many
we could have
contacts?
anything up
We could
from
have
300 to
anything up from
500
300 to
wow.
500 people contact
That's
us.
over a few
Uh,
different
that's
sites.
over a few
It's all
different
two different
sites.
sites,
It's all two different sites, not
another
just
one
my
that
dust
I
one, but another one that I have.
have. Some of them,
Some of them,
obviously,
we need to
teams because
pass on
they
to other
might come in
teams
from
because
different
they might come
states.
in from
We
different
might have
states,
some
and we need to
in that
pass
area
them on
that
to
can help
somebody in
them.
that area that can help them.
Others, we can
Others,
sometimes
we
help a
can
lot of
sometimes
people
help a lot of
without even
people
having to go out
without
and
even
giving
having to
them
go out there
some
by giving them
instruction
some
on how they can take a bit
instruction
of
on how they can
control,
take a bit of control, how they
do a bit of
can do a
protection,
bit of
how they
protection,
can
how they can
do a few little bits and
do a few
pieces,
little
use
bits
some
and pieces, use
crystals,
some
things like that
crystals,
to
things
help
like
them
that
out. So there's
to help them
a
out. So there's
vast
a
majority of those that
vast
we can help
majority of
without
those
having
that
to
we
go
can
out
help
there.
without having to go out there.
Actual
Actual
investigations
investigations
could be anywhere
could
from,
be anywhere from
I think the lowest
I
amount
think
since I
the
found the
lowest
dust
amount
has been
since I
about
found a
20 in
dust
the
has been
year,
about 20 in the year, and
the
longest the
longest
most was
47.
about
That's still a
47
lot for a year.
investigations. It is,
I mean, you
yeah.
must spend most of your weekends on the road somewhere or researching at least.
Or
Yeah,
for me, a lot
or
of people
I mean, a lot of people
don't really understand what's
don't really
involved
understand what's
in a full
involved in a
case.
full case.
You could
You
people
could,
just think you turn up,
people just
investigate,
think
and
you
go
turn
home
up,
again. But
investigate, and go home again. But
kind of wish that was
I
true.
kind of wish that was
You're
true. But
looking at good 2 or 3
you're looking
hours
at
work
good 2 or 3 hours work before each case by talking to the clients, interviewing them,
giving them some tips and help,
giving them some tips and help,
answering their
and
calls, trying to
answering their
alleviate
calls, trying to
their nerves
alleviate
a little bit,
their nerves a little bit,
to contacting the
to
team to see if
contacting the
everyone can
team
get
to see
there,
if everyone can get there,
organising who is and isn't going to
organising who
go,
is and
giving
isn't
them
going to
details of where
go,
we've got
giving
to
them
go
details of where
to,
we've got to go to,
the investigation
the
itself.
investigation
And then
itself.
that's the
And
easy part
then
of the job.
that's the easy part of the
Yeah.
job.
The short part.
The short part.
That doesn't sound like an
The
easy job,
The
Frank.
long part's.
That sounds like a very.
Well,
The
that's
short
what's the
part.
easy, but the short part.
The long part starts from
The
there,
long
where we've
part
got to
starts
go
from
through all
there,
the
where we've
data
got to
from
go through
all
all
the
the data
recordings
from
and
all of the
see if
recordings and see if we've
any
captured
evidence.
any evidence.
If
So,
you think, we've got a
if you think,
16
we've got a 16 camera CCTV system, so if I've got even just eight of them up recording for 6 hours, there's 48 hours there of just watching video, plus your handheld video on top of that, plus your handheld audio, your static audio. So you could be have over 100 hours worth of data to go through just from one case.
Wow.
So and then you've got
So and then you've got obviously all your, many of your team members as they can help out. And then on top of that, I've got to go through what everyone else tags and work out what is and isn't evidence and do it all up and present it from there. So then you've got to go back and have a meeting with the client and let them know what we've come up with evidence-wise or data-wise and see how they're going and that sort of thing. And then trying to touch base with them every month or.
Hello, you still there, Rick? Have we lost Rick?
I can hear you. I can hear you, and it's showing that Rick's online. But yes, that might be him.
Rick,
might
are you back?
Be him.
Am I still there?
Yes,
back.
You're there.
Am I still
That's
there?
good. We just you dropped out for a little bit for some reason.
Did I?
Yes.
Oh, did I?
Well, look, I think you sound extremely organized, don't you agree, Sheila? I mean, I'm just amazed at the amount of work you must do. Have we dropped out again?
No.
That was just an awkward silence.
The net's been really bad.
Okay, well, I'll take an awkward silence out of rather than a dropout any day. How about you two?
We'll be going to a break in about 4 minutes.
Okay, so shall I ask a short one?
I hope you've got lots of questions about all the equipment, Sharon.
Oh, I do.
Afterwards.
I've got lots here.
Good.
So Rick, why don't you just? We might start talking about when a ghost is not being sensed, that seen, heard, or felt by the living. Do they still exist in our physical world?
I personally believe they absolutely do.
A lot of people believe that you investigate at night because they only come out at night, but they're there through the day, they're there all the time. Just because the daylight sort of comes around doesn't mean they go.
They're all around us all the time.
So, do you think there's? I mean, I know a lot of people believe that they're kind of interdimensional as well. What are your feelings on that? Because, I mean, if you look at how transparent ghosts are, and a lot of people believe that what we're actually seeing is, say, another dimension. Are we going to break?
And we'll be back shortly. We've got about 6 or 7 minutes, guys. If anyone wants to go get a coffee.
Okay, break. I'll see you in a tick.
Things were not quite right, that everything was just ever so slightly askew.
Do you have, to paraphrase Morpheus, a splinter in your mind?
If you're interested in hearing the latest information about UFOs, the paranormal,
ancient cultures and structures,
monatomic elements,
longevity,
fantastic discoveries in science,
download it to your brain,
then tune in to us. Hi, I'm Dave.
And I'm Mackie.
And we are Shiny Side Out, Sundays 2 to 4 a.m. Eastern. See you then.
Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com. You don't need to expect us. We're already here.
And this is Rocco.
And the Bo and Rocco Show is here to offer insight into legal and lawful remedies. Our goal is to remain free and help others remain free in an ever-increasing police-like state. With the help of our guests, we try to answer questions such as what went wrong and what can we do about it.
So tune into Revolution Radio at www.freedomslips.com Wednesday nights, 10 to 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time to listen to the Bo and Rocco Show.
You don't need to expect us.
We're already here.
Revolution Radio.
And how fucking dare anyone out there criticize Hillary? After all she's been through. She lost in 2008, her daughter had a fucking kid, her husband turned out to be a user and a cheater, and now she's under investigation from the FBI and the State Department. All you people care about is honesty and integrity. What you don't realize is that she started the Stop Trump Fund because she's hoping people will hate him more. Leave her alone.
You're lucky she even campaigned for you bastards.
Leave Hillary Clinton alone right now. I mean it. Leave her alone.
That are planning to vote for Trump. They're not
They don't necessarily like him that much.
And they don't necessarily agree.
And they don't necessarily agree with him.
They're not racist and rednecks or.
They're actually pretty decent people.
So after talking to a number of them, I wanted to write this, and Donald Trump came to the Detroit Economic Club
and stood there in front of the Ford Motor executives.
And said, if you close these factories as you're planning to do in Detroit and build them in Mexico, I'm going to put a 35% tariff on those cars when you send them back, and nobody's going to buy them. It was an amazing thing to see. No politician, Republican or Democrat, had ever said anything like that to these executives. And it was music to the ears of people in Michigan and Ohio and Pennsylvania. In Wisconsin, the Brexit states. You live here in Ohio, you know what I'm talking about. Whether Trump means it or not is kind of irrelevant because he's saying the things to people who are hurting. And it's why every beaten down, nameless, forgotten working stiff who used to be part of what was called the middle class loves Trump. He is the human Molotov cocktail that they've been waiting for. The human hand grenade that they can legally throw into the system that stole their lives from them. And on November 8th, Election Day, although they've lost their jobs, although they've been foreclosed on by the bank, next came the divorce, and now the wife and kids are gone. The car's been repoed. They haven't had a real vacation in years. They're stuck with the shitty Obamacare bronze plan where you can't even get a fucking Percocet. They've essentially lost everything they had.
Except one thing that doesn't cost them a cent and is guaranteed to them by the American Constitution, the right to vote.
They might be penniless, they might be homeless, they might be sober and stuffed. It doesn't matter because it's equalized on that day. A millionaire has the same number of votes as the person without a job. One. And there's more of the former middle class than there are in the millionaire class. So on November 8th, the dispossessed will walk into the voting booth, be handed a ballot, close the curtain, and take that lever or felt pen or touchscreen and put a big X in the box by the name of the man who has threatened to upend and overturn the very system that has ruined their lives. Donald J. Trump. They see that the elites who ruined their lives hate Trump. Corporate America hates Trump.
Wall Street hates Trump.
The career politicians hate Trump.
The media hates Trump. After they loved him and created him.
And now hate him. The enemy of my enemy is who I'm voting for on November 8th.
On November 8th, Joe Blow, Steve Blow, Bob Blow, Billy Blow,
all the blows get to go and blow up the whole goddamn system because it's your right.
Trump's election is going to be the biggest few ever recorded in human history.
And it will feel good.
All right, folks, don't forget. Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com. Get out there. November 8th. Let's give them you.
Revolution Radio.
Revolution Radio. Their information.
Never sleeps.
Never sleeps.
Enter into a world unseen on Raven Star's Witching Hour. You will encounter eclectic topics from the realm of spirit brought into our matrix of truth. With your host, Solaris Blue Raven, Solaris will bring you an array of unique guests covering topics from ghostly spirits to amazing anomalies, covert technology, UFOs, and shadowy global events.
And that's right here at Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, Saturdays, midnight till 2 a.m. Eastern Time. Revolution Radio, where information never sleeps.
Let the magic rise.
Is your data safe? Do
you have the necessary information to assist you in confidently living through just about any survival situation. It's survival and gardening, off-grid living, medical knowledge, or even natural or man-made EMPs on your list of personal concerns. You have your documents and your personal information in a safe place in your hands where you know where it is. Well, check out our preloaded EMP-proof thumb drive. Over 3 gigs of survival documents and how-tos, plus the USDA offline food preservation website, and much, much more, including a surprise bonus we just can't tell you about. With plenty of room left over to store your most important documents. Imagine if a megavirus or a computer failure took out your bank, or all the banks for that matter. Are your banking records safe in your hands? So when they get things fixed and repaired, you can say, hey, look, this is what I had. You have it. I want it back. Is your personal data safe? Family records, addresses, phone numbers? We'll squeeze on over to freedomslips.com. Yes, that's www.freedomslips.com. Click the banner on the homepage for the EMP-proof bullet drive to get the full scoop of everything that we offer. So, folks, keep your data safe for your peace of mind. Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com. You don't need to expect us. We're already here.
Enjoy your
extra big-ass fries.
You didn't give me no fries. I got an empty box.
Would you like another?
Extra big-ass fries.
I said I didn't get any.
Thank you. Your account has been charged. Your balance is zero. Please come back when you can afford to make a purchase.
No.
I'm sorry you're having
trouble.
Come
on.
Starving. Thank you for tuning in to Revolution Radio. Here at Revolution Radio, we believe in freedom of ideas, freedom of speech, but above all, we believe in freedom of existence through self-reliance. This station is 100% listener-supported, and as a fundraising promotion, I had a kick-ass free gift for a $100 donation. 35,000 seeds. 25 years in the freezer. Long-term storable, 54 different varieties. So, if food prices go crazy, the shit hits the fan, or if you just want to save tons of money every year by creating your own food like I do, grab our seed pack special. Just look for the banner on the homepage at freedomslips.com. Don't be a statistic. Don't be part of the problem. Be part of the solution. We need, as humans, to start taking care of ourselves and not depending on the megacorps to provide unhealthy, nasty food. Included in this package is also a DVD with 900 survival and off-grid living documents and the offline home canning how to do everything website all on the DVD. So when you're growing all that food, you know how to can it, store it, preserve it, etc. with all these documents. So thank you for tuning in to Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com. I hope that you will pick up this package and start learning to be free. Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, where information never sleeps and freedom is one seed that needs to be planted.
What are we doing live?
The opinions expressed on this radio station, its programs, and its website by the hosts, guests, and call-in listeners or chatters are solely the opinions of the original source who expressed them. They do not necessarily represent the opinions of Revolution Radio and freedomslips.com, its staff, or affiliates. You're listening to Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, 100% listener-supported radio, and now we return you to your host.
Good evening, you're back with Sheila Kennedy, and welcome to the 1%. And it's our last Thursday of the month roundtable with Sharon Ann Rowland, and we have the wonderful Rick Burden as our guest this evening. So, Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, is the number one 100% listener supported radio station bringing this show this evening to you. And because we're listener supported, we rely on you. Our wonderful listeners to keep us on air. So if you can afford to donate a little or a lot, we really do appreciate you. We have a wonderful store on the Revolution Radio website, or you can join our chat room, which is free, and we have a donate button on the bottom left in the chat room for people who'd like to donate if they're in chat, and we have the archives. So for the cost of $4.95 a month, a cup of coffee from my perspective, you can access the archives of all of the shows, all of the hosts on both Studio A and Studio B. So our last Thursday of the month, my co-host Sharon Ann Rowland, author of the Crystal Channeler series. Hi, Sharon Ann. And also the Oddities E-Club magazine, which is online. And welcome back, Sharon and Rick.
I think my question got a bit interrupted before. Basically, what the question was a lot of people talk about interdimensional beings in the ufology field, and a lot of ufologists actually believe that what the paranormal people see as ghosts are actually interdimensional beings, Rick. What do you think about that as a paranormal? Because I'm in one camp and you're in the other, so I'm open to all ideas.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's always good to keep an open mind in this field. Definitely. I guess, in a way, I understand what people are referring to when they're talking about different dimensions. And unfortunately, I don't think it's going to be until we die that we actually work out what's going on. And I hope that's not for a very, very long time for us all. But I do believe there are different planes, different or some people call them dimensions, absolutely. I do believe that that's why we do see them in more of a transparent form.
And I guess there are different levels of different planes for different people on different paths of their journey. I agree. You've actually put it exactly the way that I would have explained it too. So I think mostly the interdimensional comes in because of the transparency of ghosts. It's in ufology, a lot of people see shadow people. And I know in paranormal, there's also the shadow people are also discussed quite a lot, aren't they, Rick?
Most definitely, yes.
And you would say that they were also transparent, but they are more of a darker transparency, a darker grey to dark, to like a black. Whereas interdimensional ghosts really are more of the paler white. Is that how your understanding of it is?
Yeah, pretty much. You'll see your different shades, your darker ones are trying to hide in the darkness and the shadows.
The word shade. What does shade mean to you?
Just a white shade of black, so it's not actually a terminology.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, that's what I'm trying to actually understand. The paranormal, as I mentioned earlier, the way people label things, and I know that some people call ghost shades for some reason, and I've never really understood where that comes from. Do you know what the history of that is?
I don't personally know. I personally use the word shade because different people see, like, for example, what I might see as white, somebody else might call grey, or what I call black, somebody else might call a dark grey or a charcoal. So that's why I like using the word shade, because it sort of gives me a bit of coverage for people saying, no, you're wrong, it's grey.
So what you might refer to as a shade, we might refer to as a shadow person, or what paranormal people might refer to as a ghost or an apparition, we might refer to as an interdimensional being.
Yes, definitely.
It's interesting, isn't it, Sheila, how labeling, you know, kind of divides us, whereas, as I said, I'm hot on the topic of just treating everything as an entity. You know, and there are all various different types of entities out there. But it's interesting now that, are you finding this too, the fields, ufology, paranormal, and even conspiracy and fringe science, they all kind of interlap?
Yeah,
Oh, definitely.
Like if you stick, usually people step into one area and then in a few years' time they move into the other area, don't they? Or they kind of bounce between the two.
There are a lot.
That's right, there's certainly a lot of people that do that, definitely.
They're becoming more and more widely accepted, as Sheila mentioned earlier, too.
So, obviously, something got you on this path to becoming a paranormal investigator, Rick. Is this something that's happened to you, like you had an experience in early childhood, or is it just hit you one day as an adult?
I was a bit of a late bloomer.
I didn't really have my first paranormal experiences until I was about 17, nearly 18. Prior to that, it was all it was Casper the Ghost on TV.
The movies were great.
Yes.
Yes. After I left home, I lived at a surf club for about six months, and then I moved into a part of a garage of one of the members of the surf club, one of the families from there. They'd done up into a little guest room, and I moved into there for a while, and it was in that garage that I had a lot of experiences that absolutely freaked me out to start with.
Tell us some.
Basically, the first thing I ever noticed was when I came in, I had to get it going through the laundry, which led into the garage to go into my room. And I the manhole cover to the roof was in the laundry. And I'd come, I'd be working security at night in a memorial club at the time. So I'd be home late. The family would all be asleep because they had day jobs or school or what have you. And I'd come home and the manhole cover would be open. So I'd grab a chair, climb up, put it, close it again. So I had this sort of tiny phobia of spiders crawling into my mouth at night while I was sleeping. So I'd always
close it. Tiny phobia. That was major. Wow.
So I'd then go into the room, go into the house, make a sandwich, grab a drink, come back, I'd be gone for three minutes, four minutes tops, and the manhole cover would be off again.
Well, that sounds like a poltergeist, not just a ghost, an active poltergeist, like having fun with you.
I still to this day think it was just an earthbound entity that was just a bit of a prankster. They were never doing anything aggressive towards me. But it started slowly escalating. I had a little mini pool table in the garage and it had a bowed piece of plywood where the balls would drop into the holes and then it had rolled to either end and hit up against a timber stopper. It's a very distinct sound when that's bumped and the balls roll up a little bit and roll back and hit that timber stopper. That would get bumped frequently throughout the night. The sound of sticks being hit on the ground. The father of the family did his own home brew, so he always had hundreds of milk bottles, milk crates filled with milk bottles, and you bump them, and it's a distinct clinking of the bottles, and that'd constantly get bumped. You'd see shadow people walk, like shadows of people walking across the going across the wall, and I was in the backyard. There was no way anybody could be walking outside to create that shadow. Took me a little while, but then I started to realise, well, they're not doing anything to me. So, just live with that sort of thing. I even spoke to the person that lived there before I moved in and said to him one day, anything weird ever happen? He just went white, and we just started rattling off things to each other that we all experienced, both experienced the exact same things. The next couple of places I moved to didn't really have much activity going on. And then I moved into this old single garage that was converted to a fully self-contained granny flat. Which had a lounge area, bed area, had a little kitchenette, little laundry and toilet and shower and all that sort of thing. There was no space in the roof at all. It was filled with filling, and there was a corrugated tiled roof back in the old tiled days, not iron. And I was only there for a matter of maybe a month, and I started hearing the sounds of, and I knew exactly what the sound was because my uncle owned a two-story house, and it sounded like I was on the ground level of a two-story house hearing. I always thought it was two to three sets of footsteps. I always thought it was kids because they were lighter footsteps running up the stairs and running around upstairs. Anybody that was at the there with me, like my best mate, come over and we'd hang out, or a few friends would pop over or what have you. If they were there between 5 and 11 and there for an extended period, everybody heard it. So it wasn't just me. I even got on the roof and to see if it was just echoing from something else. I couldn't see a two-story house, a 360-degree view from where I was.
Conversational piece
when friends were around and they heard it. We never knew what it was.
I was there at the house for about nine months, and I had the experience of waking up.
I don't know if I actually did wake up, or if I dreamt it, or if I had a vision while I was asleep. But I had the experience or the sensation of waking up and hearing my landline phone dial. And when I say dial, it was one of those old rotary ones. You had to stick your finger in the number and twist it round and let it go, and then stick your finger in the next number.
I went to sit up and I couldn't move.
I had tingling on my shoulders, my hips, and my legs.
It wasn't hurting me, it wasn't pushing me down.
It was just stopping me from moving. I remember the time distinctly on my bedside clock was 3:14. I couldn't see the phone because it was on the other side of the bedside, little chest of drawers, and down on a coffee table lower. But it dialed 10 numbers. Next thing I know, I'm waking up at 7 o'clock the next morning when my alarm went off.
A few months later, I was at TAFE, and we were all talking, and the conversation somehow came around to ghosts
and that sort of thing, and I told everybody about what had happened that night. One of the people said, well, did you call Telecom and ask him if any numbers were dialed from the phone? I said, well, honestly, I didn't even think about it, so no. Went home that night, called Telecom, trying to explain the story to this poor lady on the other end of the phone. She covered up the microphone a few times. I swear she was saying she had a nut job to co-workers. When I finished explaining, she's gone, well, let's see if this actually happened, shall we? And I could hear her typing on the keyboard. There's a pause for about 30 or 40 seconds. She says, oh, well, there actually was a phone number called at that time of night. The call lasted 14 seconds. I'm like, really? So I got the phone number off her, went back to TAFE the next day, and I'm like, there was a number called.
Did you call it?
Everyone's like, well, did you call it? I'm like, what am I going to say? Hi, I think a ghost called you. That's just sort of, didn't know what to say. So I sat on the number for a few weeks, finally plucked up the courage to call it, and the lady answered the phone. I said, look, I'm really sorry to disturb you. I'm not going to hassle you. If you hang up on me, I won't call back, but please hear me out. She's gone, well, go on. So I started explaining everything that had been happening, and explained to her the footsteps, explained to her what happened that night when I was pinned down in my bed, and that's how I've come to get your number. I got the number from this is the number that was dialed. She said, where do you live? So I told her the suburb, and she said, what street? I told her the street.
She said, let me guess, if you pull in off the main road opposite
the Fisher Co-op, you're on the very first corner on the left. How the heck did you know that? She said, I used to live there. I said, what, really, in the house or the granny flat? And she said, no, she said, when we lived there, it was about 20 years ago, and it was a double-story house.
I'm like, whoa, there goes the hairs on my arms already.
I said, wow. And then she just burst into hysterical tears. I kept apologising for upsetting her. And she finally calmed down a little bit. And she said, no, it's not your fault. She said, do you mind if I ask what happened? And she said, yeah. She said, the house caught on fire one night. She said, my husband and I made it out, and the three kids didn't.
Oh, no. So that's... Okay, well, that explains a lot.
It does, yeah.
Yeah. So, the next day, a couple of days later, I went up to the library, found the microfiche film, and found the newspaper clipping on the front page cover of it, and had the little oval shaped pictures of the three kids and a picture of the house after it had burnt down and been put out. And
from that night onwards, though,
from the time she said to me, she said, "How do they sound?" I said, "Sounds like having a ball, you know, running around, playing each other, chasing each other, you know." She said, "Oh, the little buggers used to do that all the time." She said, "I'd give anything to hear it again." And I said, "I think they sound great, you know, like they're just having a ball." From that night on, I never heard the noise again.
Well, that was meant to be, wasn't it?
It was. So
that's what really drove me into wanting to know more about the field. I wanted to know how they got the phone number of where Mum and Dad used to live. I wanted to know how they were able to dial the phone. And had so many questions. There was no internet 20+ years ago. No internet. No nothing. That I could research very few books on the paranormal in the library, and so I started looking around. I finally found a team to join, an amazing team down in Sydney, and they taught me a heck of a lot. And then I moved up to Queensland, and
I'd like to think I learned something from each team.
I was with about four teams before I found D.U.S.T. I'd like to think I learned something from each team. And I was with them. I had to join them for a reason. I think things do happen for a reason.
Learning experience.
Now, Rick, you've been with the magazine for a long time. You're actually one of my longest columnists. Did you know that?
Oh, I didn't know.
It's awesome. It's a fantastic magazine.
Thank you very much.
I love it.
And now, there was three particular articles you've written for me. Would you mind if I just asked you about a few questions about each of them?
Certainly, I'll hopefully remember.
I'll give you a bit of an overview. The first is in mid-2015, so it was about July 2015, you were contacted by a family in regard to an old lady spirit that was bruising their 9-month-year-old baby and their 4-year-old child. It was a private residence haunting, and you did a psychic investigation in that particular... Yeah, that's right. You just did the psychic investigation. You didn't worry about the technical case. Do you remember it well enough to tell us a little bit more about it, or shall I just ask you questions?
Probably better off asking questions at this stage. I do remember the case, but there have been about four very similar cases we've worked. So they're all kind of blending into one a little bit.
Yes, I know. You do so many. I can well understand it. Now, in this case, you had to break the spirit attached to the children as well as the adults.
Yes.
How different is it breaking an attachment to a child, and what is the process you do to detach a child or an adult from a spirit that's attached to them?
Both for us are very, very different.
With children, you don't want to scare them,
so you try not to tell them what's going on. So we try to, with younger children, play games with them.
Any old game, ring around the rosy, or musical seats, or anything to get the kids laughing. The more they're laughing, the happier they are. The more the vibrations are rising, and the more those vibrations raise, the easier it is to try and deal with things like attachments and such.
And we call in for higher beings to help out in that sort of situation with the kids to come in and do it psychically. What do you guys see as sensitives when you see an attachment? Can you describe it?
It's kind of in a way like a tree trunk growing out of a tree.
Like a branch coming out of the trunk. So different barriers, different levels of thickness. Most of them just sort of attach and go into the body. Others, I've never seen it before. In another case, it was very similar. On a 9-year-old girl, the ethereal cord went straight through her from front to back and came out on the side. I've never ever seen anything like it before. But usually it's just sort of like a branch coming off a tree trunk, just comes out. When you see these attachments,
do you automatically think they're a negative attachment? Are there ever positive attachments?
No, No, look, there's definitely
positive attachments. There's, you know, your earthbound entities, family and things like that, that try to attach to continue to be with them wherever they go. We usually do look to clean them all off, and if they are of the light, then they will be able to come back again. But if they're not of the light, then generally in most cases, unless they're called back by the people themselves, then they're gone.
I've had somebody in the past that I've interviewed equate attachments to the phenomena of multiple personalities. Have you seen anything that might support that theory?
Without sort of knowing their full theory behind it,
I can understand where they're coming from, but I don't believe all attachments would do that. Multiple personalities can be just the spirit pushing, if it is spiritual, of course, can just be the spirit pushing their own thoughts and stuff onto the person, and the person's then carrying that out, whether that's done through attachments or even possession to a certain degree.
So obviously, case by case basis,
you'd need to determine that and look into that.
I found that a fascinating theory because it would actually make sense. It's kind of a logical answer to multiple personalities in the one body, isn't it?
They don't always need to be attached to you to do that as well. It could just be like we've had a case where somebody was just a completely different person in the house. As soon as they left the house, they were fine. They were normal. They're normal. and it just happened to be a spirit in the house that was pushing these feelings and emotions and all that sort of stuff on the person. They had no attachment at all. It was just the spirit in the house that was able to push those thoughts and reactions onto the person.
Thank you. Now, in this particular investigation, you set up, and you probably do this at all of your investigations, I'm sure, you set up what you termed a white vortex of light around the site.
That's right.
Tell us about that. That just fascinated me. A white vortex of light.
It's a lot like the process in the protection procedure that we went through when you were with us on the investigation at the jail, where we just look to bring some light from the furthest most reaches of the universe, bring it all the way down and surround, in this case, the property. We then get the vortex moving.
I
don't like it stagnant, so I like to. That's where the vortex comes in, where it starts slowly spinning. And obviously white light is one of the better lights to work with, so that's why it was a white vortex. Anything of the light, any beings of the light can pass through it, no problem at all. But anything that's not of the light and not pure can't pass through it. So we take that white light all the way down into the center of the earth and all the way out to the furthest most reaches of the universe. So it just cannot escape.
Now, on this particular haunting, can I use that word? Haunting? Yeah.
Sure.
I ask a lot of questions like that because I like to get the correct terminology right. But on this particular haunting, you hit a rather stubborn old lady. She was the one that was actually bruising the baby and the toddler in the house. How do you move on stubborn spirits? I mean, if they're stubborn, obviously it was her house and she didn't know why they were living in her house, which is fair enough, I suppose. You obviously hit quite a few. I know when we were at the Boggo Road Jail on that investigation, when we were up in the guardhouse, there was a number of stubborn spirits there too. How do you, let's say that they just don't want to move on. How do you move them on from that point?
Some you can't.
There's a gentleman that was dealing drugs when he was alive, and he doesn't believe he deserves to be able to move on. But others, you can get to the point where you can force them to move on by calling in higher beings, and they come in and do the job. But a lot of it comes down to, as we were talking before, to counselling, trying to make them understand that they're no longer physically living, they've passed away, trying to make them understand that moving on is the next step in their journey. It's not the end of it. Doesn't mean that they're finished. I personally believe they can come back if they're here to watch over something. They just need to go through, we don't know what, maybe a bit of counselling or something, and then move on to the next phase of their journey. But they can certainly come back. I believe. So it's just a matter of getting them to understand the situation.
And have you been in contact with the family since the investigation ended to see if it's all okay or the kids are not being brutal?
Yeah, I've contacted a number of times. Everything's been fantastic ever since we've been there. They haven't had any other problems. I believe they did use the Ouija board right at the beginning when they had some happenings. They've never used that again.
So that was kind of brought everything into the house. So it wasn't... Apart from the old lady.
There was already stuff there, but they tried to communicate with it to try and tell it to nick off, and it made matters worse.
I've been told to steer clear, so that's your advice too, obviously.
I've got mixed opinions. If you don't know what you're doing, if you don't know how to protect yourself, and you don't know how to call in for the right beings or entities or what have you to come through, and you don't know how to deal with something if the wrong thing comes through, definitely steer clear of it. I'd say 95%+ of our cases are because somebody has used a Ouija board at the location. But they can also, on the same time, if you know what you're doing with it, and you know how to ask for the right beings, you know how to protect yourself, you know how to deal with something if it comes through that's not what you're after, then they can actually be a fantastic tool for people as well. I know some investigators in Sydney that use them religiously, and they on investigations and they swear by them. So
it's not something I'm personally
comfortable with using, but
if I was actually on a case with them, I would have the confidence in them and the confidence in my own protection that I would participate.
While we're on the subject of like devices, there's been a lot of talk in the community, mostly due to a recent international fly-in, fly-out personality whose name shall not be used here. What do you think of table tipping?
I've heard a couple of different definitions of this, so maybe if I can get you to explain which one you're referring to.
Well, basically the gentleman that came round used it as a means of clearing spirits from the area.
I hadn't either, and
the technique was demonstrated at the beginning of his presentation, and it really wasn't that awe-inspiring, I shall say. But I did some research on it, and it actually used to be a parlor trick in the Victorian age. Because in the Victorian age, they were all into the occult, and it was done with afternoon tea, basically. And they'd have seances and all that sort of thing. But it was more for an entertainer's tool. And so you don't use it yourself in any way, shape, or form, obviously.
We like to work with the light,
visualize things, calling for higher beings to help, that sort of thing.
I think it's probably the better way to go.
it's different for everybody.
I mean, it's like the protection. When we went through that, that's just one way of doing it. If you believe reading the guide on how to work your TV remote is going to give you protection, then
that's fantastic.
If that's what you believe, and that's what you think's going to work for you, then do it.
Rick, you actually changed my means of protection that day because I loved the concept of imagining Archangel Michael coming up behind me and in enveloping me or encasing me in his wings.
And
that whole image has, I've used that from that point forward for protection, and it's been amazing. So I have to thank you very much for that.
Oh, that's a pleasure, I think.
That wasn't my idea. I can't claim credit for that. It's one of the other ladies that was there that...
Yeah, she was on
an actual workshop not long before that, and that was what she told me. She used as her what I call protective icon.
So I definitely can't take full credit for it,
but it's something I've been mentioning to people when we've been talking about protection ever since, though.
It's quite a quick way of doing it, too.
So if you don't have time
to really meditate or, you know, start to conjure up your golden energy and, you know, because because each of your sensitives has a different way of preparing themselves for an investigation, that might take quite a few minutes for you all to get your stuff going before you go in, obviously.
I usually do it before I get to the location,
even while I'm driving. I'll do it then.
That way I'm prepared when I get there.
Now, let's go jump to another investigation, and it's probably my favourite article that you've written. It was in the last issue, issue 11 of the magazine, and it was on the historical theatre investigation you organised and ran in April 2015 out west of Brisbane. Now, was this like a mass sighting of apparitions? Because I loved this article so much. Because you had like apparitions coming out of every doorway, every room. It just sounded phenomenal. Do you remember that one well enough to give us a bit of an overview?
That was a pretty interesting one. We did another theatre not long after that one as well, up in the Childers, which was just chalk and cheese to me. Childers was pretty cool.
it was just amazing
the different levels of things that we were finding and that we were down that little hidden basement that the owners didn't even know about, which was pretty awesome. I couldn't believe that they broke out the equipment and started busting down the wall right in front of us. I'm sitting there thinking, oh my God, this is a historic place.
I didn't realise. I'm actually looking at the article again now, and you're right, they did too, didn't they? They actually, they must, and that was all on just that a hunch. It was one of the sensitives picked up in the room.
We'd been talking with them quite a bit, and we'd all given her a lot of information about her and her family just sitting there having lunch beforehand. So she knew we weren't faking abilities or anything like that. I think that's why she took it a bit more on faith when we told her that was happening.
Let me just sum up for everybody listening. I've got the list here. The apparitions that you saw during this historic theatre investigation, there were two apparitions in different sections of the lower seated area, both sitting in a seat and looking up, watching something on the stage, one male, one female. There was also an apparition of a young man walking stage left down the aisle, wall side, an apparition of a man seen to be walking around on the stage, an apparition of a lady at the top of the mezzanine level on stage right side near a window. She would appear to be vividly trying to stop people from going to that area, not with any violence, but people got the feeling she was trying to keep them from harm.
Yes.
Quite a few of your team got excited to experience the feeling of a rocking boat when you walked on that area.
Yeah.
A bit of vertigo,
gave you the vertigo, sea leggy sort of feeling. It was a bizarre experience.
And lastly, and I love this one, an apparition of a lady that was seen shushing people in the foyer. But is this also the investigation where the piano was playing at points by itself?
I think it was the one at backstage.
So Sheila, how about that? And this was a multi-witness. You know, multiple people heard the piano, and all of your people pretty much experienced one form of apparition together or on their own. Is that not the case?
Everyone had at least an experience that night of something.
Awesome, isn't it?
Phenomenal, yeah. And on top of all of that, they then sensed that there was a basement, and the owner had absolutely how long had the owner owned the place, Rick?
Wasn't very long. It was just under a year or just over a couple of years. I'm getting that and Childers mixed up at the moment in that regard.
But it wasn't a hugely long period.
But she didn't. She had no concept that she actually had a basement.
No, neither did the gentleman
that was working there, who had worked for the last two owners of the theatre.
Basically, they went down, Sheila, and they actually found additional real estate for them as well. They opened it up, and I think they're so game, they actually walked into the space. Were you one of the ones that went into the basement, Rick?
I was the first one.
How did you, seriously, what were you feeling walking into? I mean, obviously you had some type of torch or lamp or something.
Oh, of course I had a torch, absolutely. Never go anywhere without them during an investigation. But it was more excitement
than anything. I was just, yeah,
giddy as a school kid, as
giddy
they,
as
say.
A school kid, like, as they say. I was just like, woohoo! Get down there and see all the clothes racks full of the old vintage clothing and all that sort of stuff from obviously past performances and stuff. I was more enthralled in that than the couple of entities that were down there.
That's wonderful. I mean, that meant that she could then display that in the foyer down the track.
She was talking about creating a museum that night in the basement. No, out the front.
So, to my mind, after all the articles you've written, that was the one that I thought, my God, I need to go here. I need to visit this theatre myself. So,
yeah, it was about three and a half, nearly four hours west of Brisbane, kind of near the border
of New South Wales, down that way.
No, it was more westish, south west.
Roma way, yeah. Longreach, that kind of way.
Close, yeah. They do want to keep it quiet where it is.
So in case any television ghost hunters want to check it out.
Yes, or other teams and all that sort of stuff.
So would you count that as your most full-on and active investigation ever, or has there been another?
It'd probably be one up there, in the top three. I've had some pretty interesting experiences. Bogo Road Jail, for example, is a really good location. But I'd say overall, it'd probably be very close. If it wasn't number one, it'd have to be number two. It was just awesome. I still get chills thinking about some of the things that happened there.
Well, let's talk about Bogo Road Jail now. Obviously, your job, you have a job there. Your work office is actually in the jail. Is that correct?
It certainly is, yeah.
Typing along and the computer suddenly shuts down, who do you blame?
They're not really game to mess with me too much up there.
especially after when we did our dust investigation up there and I had to go into one of the cell blocks and give them a massive spray.
Oh, I remember that. Was that block? The infamous block F or J? I can't remember. That was it.
F-wing.
I was in J at the time when all that went down. I know that there was definitely some really dark energy in one of the cells there. On the second layer, it was up when you go up the stairs, and just if you turn left at the top of the stairs in there, there was just some awful dark energy, and the graffiti in there was just awful, wasn't it?
Oh yes, I love walking around all the cells and looking at the graffiti. It's pretty morbid stuff, but some pretty cool stuff there.
I don't think people realise how tiny those cells were, you know, or are, and were. I mean, I couldn't imagine putting a dog in that size.
Yeah, let alone no sewage, no plumbing or anything either.
Literally a can to utilise as a bathroom overnight.
So I know that on that note. night in particular, I know my photography, I picked up quite a few orbs floating around. What other activity did you pick up after, once you'd gone through all the footage? Anything exciting?
Well, you had a few things.
There was probably about four or five different occasions where the static audios that were in the cell blocks picked up the sound of a cell door slamming shut. Each time I confirmed with the two CCTV cameras that were pointing at the three cell blocks, there was absolutely nobody in any of the cell blocks when that all happened. We've also picked up the Holy Grail, an apparition on video.
Our mutual friend, I won't say her name, didn't she get pushed too?
There were quite a bit of activity that night of people getting pushed, slapped, pinched on the backside, and all of it seemed to cater around that F-wing cell block.
Well, it wasn't me, it was all targeted at the ladies.
But one lady even had a full handprint on her back from getting slapped on the back. And then not long after that, one of our investigators got pushed into the CCTV camera and static audio that we had set up on a tripod and knocked that over and broke one of my audio recorders, which I wasn't happy about. $200 piece of equipment. But that's when I went in and read the riot act, and it was like I walked in and out of that particular cell block a hundred times in the time I worked there, and I've never experienced anything like it. It was like every step I took in, it was like four or five different people, like I was walking into a crowded hall that you couldn't move in, and then every step I took, it was like they were just shoof, 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 back into the cells, like they're all ducking for cover. And I read the riot. I actually did something I never ever do. I did a Zach Bagan and challenged them to come and be a man with me and push me and try and have a go at me, and they wouldn't. And then basically I told them, you attack anybody again, you hurt anybody again, I'll get rid of you. Then I heard some laughter coming from the top levels of the cell block, and I turned around and said, don't you laugh, you know I can do it. And then the whole cell block just went quiet, and then all of a sudden I could hear crickets chirping and the traffic passing again. So they obviously took it seriously from there.
How are you feeling about the decision by our state government to sell Boggo Road?
Look, they haven't sold it. There is a proposed development in place. There is a new developer that's now been assigned. The old ones have been removed from the project. What they had submitted as their development application proposal to council, in my own personal opinion, was absolutely disgusting. They wanted to gut two cell blocks and make one a pub, one a restaurant.
I'm not permitted under contract to say much about what the new developer is, but let me just say it's chalk and cheese, and we're really looking forward to seeing what they're going to put out as their development application proposal.
That's great. Now, before we finish, because it's getting close, talk about equipment. Now, each issue, you give me a wonderful review of a piece of equipment that you use during your investigations. And I'm going to be starting to post snippets of those on the Facebook page for the magazine. So if anyone wants to.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, I was going to talk to you about that afterwards. I didn't think you'd mind. I just think it's helpful for people to buy the right equipment because, as you said before, it's costly equipment. And you don't want to stuff up by, you know, because if you do stuff up, sometimes it's $200, $300 piece of equipment and you're not getting what you actually need out of that equipment.
That's right.
Would you like to just give some highlights to people who are kind of interested in doing some investigation, maybe in their own houses or in friends' houses, that might be able to access or maybe even rent or hire?
Yeah, sure.
I don't know many places that rent or hire equipment, but purchasing equipment. I'll get one of the number one questions on equipment I get asked on my websites is what's the best first piece of equipment to buy? My answer is always the same, is a digital video recorder of some description, whether it be a straight out normal everyday video recorder or whether it be one that's converted to full spectrum or infrared. If you get one that's converted to full spectrum or infrared, of course you need either a full spectrum or infrared illuminator to go with that as well to light up the place. A lot of that you won't see with your own eyes, but the recorder definitely picks it up. The reason I recommend that as a first piece of equipment is...
Rick, are you still there? You kind of dropped out.
He has too. We're almost out of time, so he's dropped out right at the very end.
Let me see if I can quickly add him in for the end.
Oh, he's back.
There
you're back again.
Most, if not all, video recorders these days have a button you can push to take a still photo. So it's a still camera, an audio recorder, and a video recorder, all built into one.
What about handheld, like, EMF devices? Any that you'd recommend?
With any piece of equipment, I always recommend doing some research.
I always recommend looking into what it does, how it works, and then testing it yourself. For example, K2 meters, people seem to love them. I'm not a big fan of them for the simple fact that they pick up more man-made electricity, whereas I believe we're looking for natural EMF. So if you're looking for an actual EMF meter, I'd probably recommend going with a natural tri-field meter. They are a lot more expensive, but to me, K2 meters, they're a good gimmicky thing to use if you're doing ghost hunts and things like that, because they've got pretty lights that light up and give you a bit of an experience. But in saying that, up in Charters Towers, both this time and last time, there was a particular boardroom table that used to be in a different location to where it is now, but a particular gold company was doing one of their meetings, and one of the non-board members who had had some bad news about his employment came in with a pistol and demanded to see the minutes of the meeting, but this decision was made. He ended up not being able to get those minutes.
I think we're done. That's us for tonight, guys.
If you're staying around, news to me with Pamela Tolaris. So we'll be back next week. Bye now.
Thank you, Rick.
No, thank you, Sharon. Hi,
no problem.
Lovely to have you.
Hey, Sharon. Didn't realize I was that close to...
No, neither did I. Let me just add in Sheila and we'll just have a chat if I can do it.
Sure.
God, this thing's so sensitive some days. So, yeah, sorry for the start. I don't know if you realized, but I was a little bit like, oh, God, I can't believe I had to rush. I usually have more time to prep. So, but I think we entertained everybody.
Hopefully.
Yeah, she's... God, why won't it let me add her? Let me have a look. Add to call. So, anyway, never mind. Well, listen, I think there's actually more to talk about. I've still got half of my questions. And that,
yeah, I know that.
would you be interested in coming back next month? And we'll do... I've got a lady coming on called Lee Kerr, who's a ufologist. She runs the talk group. I don't know if you know of them.
No.
And I was just thinking, she kind of went 2 hours. I don't know if I can talk for 2 hours. But now I'm thinking, if you'd like to come back, we could just, between the two of you, we'd probably do 2 hours very easily.
Yeah, more than happy to.
Oh, cool. Cool. Okay, well, I'll get that set up because I've still got all these questions and... Everyone loved talking about all the investigations. We got plenty of those to discuss.
Yes, definitely.
So, do you have any questions or anything? Basically, I record these and they'll be put on YouTube. Oh, here you go.
Excellent.
She is here. Let's see if I can add her in. Sounds from source. That's cool. Oh, here she comes. She probably had to disconnect from... the server or something.
Ah, yes.
So, Sheila, yes. Are you there? Sheila? Or is she... Oh, she's still dialing in. Skype is so sensitive. I think there's a new version.
There we go.
Sheila, you there?
I am. How are you? That was great.
I think you look forward to the Thursdays because you don't get to talk. So...
Well, the last two Thursdays, I've talked for two hours, and people say I could talk underwater with a mouthful of microscopes. But no, I'm such a great interviewer. It's nice to sit back and listen.
When I've got, and yes. Most of my columnists are fascinating, don't you think, Sheila? Rick included?
Oh, absolutely.
Rick, I've still got questions, so... I've lined up Lee Kerr, who runs the talk group, she's a ufologist, but she's also into Reiki and all the stuff you love. And she was a little bit shocked at having to do 2 hours. So I was just saying to Rick, would he come back next month to join us, and then we'll have Lee and Rick on. And I think between the four of us, we could definitely do the 2 hour slot.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Yeah, that'd be fantastic.
Great. Yeah, I'll organise that. Because I've still got questions here, and we didn't even get to some of the juicier dust cases either. And we probably should give them a better understanding of the equipment. So in between now and next month, I will put on Facebook all the different reviews you've done of equipment, Rick.
Sure.
So that, because that's the number one thing that people always ask me when on the magazine, they send me these emails saying, what do you recommend I get? And normally I just send them a PDF of the reviews you've done so that they've got a better understanding, because people waste a lot of money. I know I've wasted money trying to, on Skywatch equipment, which is pretty much the same. And you've probably done it too, haven't you, Rick?
Yes.
I've got probably five, six thousand dollars
worth of equipment that just sits there collecting dust because I don't use it anymore.
Have you not heard of eBay? Before Christmas, fill up your stocking.
I'm a hoarder.
I might need it one day.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I know exactly what to do with that comment.
I keep boxes for big things like TVs and stuff
in case I've got to move and put them back into a box. So, on the garage.
That is. Now, you have seen that show on TV called Hoarders, haven't you?
No, I don't watch much TV.
I don't have one, Sharon, at all. I started walking in the morning because I'm determined to lose weight you know, at the moment. So I've started doing 10,000 steps each morning. And what I've been doing is I've been walking around my TV room. I've got a trampoline in the center. And I put on the food channel, which probably does not help, I've got to admit. and it's so 2 hours later, I've learned how, like, three different recipes. And then I flick over to 94. So I didn't, up until I've started doing this, I don't think I've seen a TV show in years. And now, you know, it's only been like 2 or 3 weeks of doing this exercise. And I think I'm now re-addicted to tiny house living and food shows. So, you know, it is, you know, you're right. You shouldn't be anywhere near a TV. It is very addictive.
I've got that Foxtel, so I'll just record what I want
and set it to series link, and then I'll a couple of hours on a Saturday or Sunday morning, I'll watch, and then that's about it. The only time I watch TV.
My daughter just signed up to Netflix, and she set up all the TVs here for Netflix.
Yep.
And my husband is addicted now to Netflix. What is that? You know, it's like on demand, is it?
Yeah, online streaming of TV shows and movies and stuff like that.
He raves about it. He says, oh, I get to see this and I get to see that. And I'm going, I know none of these shows. But he obviously just loves it. And hey, Sheila, so are you Melbourne-based at the moment?
I am, yes.
So are you
I am, yes.
Go travelling? I always, Rick, I always think of Sheila as a gypsy. I always see my visualization of Sheila is in one of those old gypsy caravans traversing the world. So she never seems to stay in the same spot for long, do you?
Well, moving here was my 88th move, and that was a lot of moves. I'm not quite that old, Rick. I'm 66. Yes, I do have some Romani blood in my background, so that's probably the itchy feet part of it. But I blame my father. He moved just when I was a child. So it's obviously Tom's fault. I'm looking at probably a three-year base, when I eventually get my furniture from Brisbane, I'm looking at a desk and a table and chairs and a lounge, but then as I tend to sit in front of the computer, but I'm looking at probably going up to Sydney maybe next week or after, and then possibly up to the Gold Coast, if not before Christmas, after Christmas, to do some work.
Well, give me a call. Look, if you want to stay over for a few days, you're more than welcome.
Thank you, that would be wonderful. I've just got to organise, you know, colleagues up there, come up and see some clients, do some teaching, do something, but it's kind of getting a little bit, and I'm still missing my granddaughter, so that's kind of kept me stuck. She went missing from a school, convinced the education department that she was a mature minor at 15. Because Western Australia did not join the Commonwealth in fact law in 1975.
So my stepfather has had custody ever since 2009.
She's 15. Got original custody in 2009 in Western Australia. Brought the kids, her and her two younger siblings, half siblings, to Victoria in 2010. Custody laws to get custody in Victoria. And then the paperwork got sent back to West Australia. So the original documentation took 5 weeks to come from the West Australian court to be passed into Victoria. So I was really rude and asked, were they swimming around the Great Australian
Bible? And Victoria wouldn't accept that document
because it doesn't say final orders, even though they've signed in custody until she's 18.
So we've had to reapply.
It's now nearly 7 weeks. to get a stamped, sealed, signed, delivered document from the court saying there aren't any further evidence. So until such date, we don't know where she is. We're just told she's safe.
Okay, I'm a little astounded. So the possibilities now for Western Australia, though, are what else can you get away with over there that you can't for the rest of the Commonwealth? It's
Family law, revenue is quite different. But the interesting thing, I did about 40 pages, I did a lot of research, and I copied and pasted about 40 pages from the Victorian Education Department. And it's quite scary, actually, what kids can get away with. The school agrees that you are a mature minor, no matter what age you are. Neither do they, your parents, that you're leaving home. As long as you nominate an adult to be the contact person at the school camps and medical reasons. So this child got let off the bus from a snow trip 100 kilometres from home.
Okay, that is not cool.
So my daughter-in-law got a message from the police at 3:30 saying, don't bother picking her up from the bus tonight. She's found alternative accommodation. And that was 12 weeks ago yesterday. We've had one text message saying, I'm fine, don't come, from her phone. So, I mean, that could be anyone's phone. And the education department said, we don't have to tell you anything until you prove custody. This is why I'm kind of country. I had 8 weeks of country and now I'm back in Melbourne because I'm just waiting on the whole solicitor thing and, whether I'm going to be taking over 15-year-old or whether something else is happening.
The
feet are a bit itchy.
Listen, on a more positive note, I've got for the next show, again, we'll have Rick. Thank you very much, Rick. That would be great. And Lee Kerr. The following show, I was thinking we might, and I've already spoken to Damien. Have you heard of Damien John Knott? He's the UFO guy who was in a movie, a documentary this year called Australian Skies.
Okay.
He's one of my, he's like Rick. He's a long-term columnist. And I thought we'd get him on in Chris at, what is it? What month are we in, guys? It's October.
October.
Okay, so Rick.
October.
I can think about it. October. So for November, we'll have Rick and Lee. At Christmas, I thought we'd invite Damien on. So what do you do around the Christmas period, Sheila? We'll still go on?
New Year's Eve thingamy, so there's a couple of
the last Thursday will be the 29th. So I'll just set it up, and in January, guess who I've got for you? Only female alien hybrid breeding program abductee, Jane Pooley.
Very good.
I thought you'd like that. What do you think of that, Rick?
I do.
Sounds great.
Yeah, I've just interviewed her, and she and I are going down to the UFO conference at Byron Bay in January. The magazine's exhibiting there, and I'm also exhibiting shortly, Rick, at Conscious Life at November 12 and 13 at the Sunshine Coast. So the magazine's going to be getting a lot more exposure hopefully over the next couple of months, and we're sponsoring the UFO conference.
Excellent.
So yeah, we're definitely getting a lot more, we're being picked up a lot overseas. We are so popular in India. I don't know why, but we are. India and China. China's even.
Probably Gaurav Tadani.
I cannot explain it. It used to be Canada. Canada seemed to be where all the conspiracists lived.
Yep.
And the UK. But But funnily enough, India and China, since they came on board, are just it's amazing. So we have a lot of followers.
Yeah, India had a huge following.
India had a huge following with Gaurav Tavani, the bloke from India that did the Haunting Australia show.
He did a lot of obviously
paranormal, but he did a lot of UFO stuff as well. He was known as the leading expert in India on paranormal and ufology.
He passed away not long ago though,
unfortunately. So we're still waiting for a message from him.
Now, guys, do you have PO boxes or addresses? Because I've just finished the books, which you're both in. Sheila, you're in the Metaphysical Musings, and Rick, you're in the Ufology, Paranormal, and Conspiracy book. And I'd like to send you both a copy.
Awesome.
So, just send me an email with a postal address and I'll send them down to you.
Yeah. Fantastic.
Yeah. Just something.
Fantastic.
And on the subject of books, are we up
and
to
on the subject of books,
you?
Are we up to volume 4?
You know what? I've done the plot line. I keep on looking at it. I'm just so busy. I've got to, this year, what I'm trying to do is bring more people on the team, you know, on the OEC team. So I'm kind of spreading the workload so I can actually do some creative activities. But every time I do that, Sheila, you know, I just seem to be thwarted because somebody gets ill. I've had a couple of people get breast cancer this year and haven't been able to, you know, after, you know, getting them, kind of training them up, and then suddenly I just feel like I'm jinxed some days. Maybe I'm just meant to do this all, you know, with just a few helpers. I don't know. I just find every time I get somebody on board, I don't know how Rick manages a team of 12. I'm so impressed with that, Rick. It's just, that's like my dream. I could retire. I'm just finding this year, like every time I get somebody trained up, and I spend a lot of time training them on certain software and that, something happens. I can't explain it. It's kind of like I'm jinxed.
Sabotage?
Oh, the universe telling you they're not quite the right person.
That's where I think it's going, you know. And so I'm listening, and. So that's why it's not that I don't want to do these things. I've got 100 million creative things I want to do. I just run out of time. But that's one of the reasons I'm trying to get fit, Sheila, so I have more energy and I can do, you know, can do a bit more multitasking. So like Rick, I mean,
if I get to see you in Brisbane, I'm in the process of going to revamp the body sculpting program I created some years ago that's not online anymore. It's called The Perfect Body For You. And I think it's a top program.
Are you going to pop that on SheilaKennedy.com?
I will eventually.
Susan hasn't spoken to me since March. That's my business partner.
That's a long time not to be speaking to your business partner.
Yeah, it's rather interesting, actually.
I did sort of reach out a white flag and say, would you mind if we had a conversation? And basically got no. Not quite set in that way. It was, what do you want to talk about? And unless it's to do with Sound Some Source, which is our website, I'm not interested. And it was like, okay, well, actually it wasn't, so we won't worry about it.
What did you do? There must have been something must have happened, but do you...
It actually wasn't something I did.
It was something Susan did. We've been in a business partnership. This is our 12th year, Rick. I channel. I don't like the word, but I'm psychic and I do. And Susan has been the quantum physics side of what we do. You know, Sheila does the woo-woo and Susan does the other stuff. So she decided in March to offer a friend of mine some help and suggested that she do this meditative process and invite these people in, and everything went horribly pear-shaped, and I spent quite a while picking up the pieces, and I realised you'll probably never work with me again, but, you know, can you please do something about the mess I've just made? And I was sort of ropeable, and I'm normally a fairly peaceable person, but I could have easily ripped through the phone and ripped her throat out.
I was somewhat annoyed.
And I'd said last year, look, I feel like I've been in bondage for the last 11 years. You know, I mean, I love working with Sounds and Source. It's a body of consciousness, Rick, that's communicated with me, and it's different every time, depending on what I'm doing. But that same sort of energy overall. And I create vibrational sound programs. So, you know, I really would like, there's some things I want to do, but, you know, I've gone on hold for such a long time, and I don't think Susan was really impressed about it, and that's where, you know, working SheilaKennedy.com comes in. But I actually got a foot in the butt 4 o'clock in the morning about 4 days ago that said, you know, where's your 5-year plan?
Get on with it.
And get on with it, kind of thing. So I was really interesting when I scribbled some notes and sort of started typing them up when it was daylight. But Sounds and Source didn't actually figure in any of it very much at all.
So 12 years is a while.
So what's there will continue, basically, but it doesn't mean that I'll continue to do a lot more.
Well, maybe you need to actually break that link.
That's my thought as well.
And being able to put my own stuff out there.
The two things that really interest me are kids, of course, the autism, ADD stuff, and the spooky stuff.
You know, the type of stuff Rick's talking about, the earthbound energy ghost, the galactic paranormal UFO kind of stuff as well. So,
Creating stuff that people can, as Rick was saying before, do themselves. Not needing to actually physically, it's dreadful, isn't it, Seth?
I don't like seeing clients, but if I can make it easier for clients not to have to come and see me, then that's better. So, I mean, we have online programs as it is, and, you know, going to the US next year, I'm going with Tina Sharon, who's competing in the Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. So I'm her BJJ granny. And we've got a new program, her and I, coming up called the Athletes Tool Sports Bag, based on a program I've got called Best Workout for You, which means you can actually work your body out without working out. And I've got one that firms up your body as well.
Exercising and releasing weight, if you can have an easy way around it,
she'll not have found it. You know that, don't you?
You know, I'm doing 12,000 steps a day, and seriously, I feel like the next day, I feel like I've killed, you know, my legs just feel so heavy. So I'd like a solution, please, immediately.
I'll find you one.
One where I can lose weight
sitting here on my computer working on my computer.
Well, I actually created a program some years ago called Best Workout for You. So the first sound in that, and it's just bells and you don't have to hear them, as Sharon will tell you, is called flexibility. The second one is called Best Workout. So if you're actually working out or going to the gym, you'll get a better workout. But if you can't work out or you can't go to the gym, you play it and it'll work your body out anyway. And then the third one's called releasing muscle tension. So you get rid of all the tight muscles after you work. I trialed them with a friend of mine at one stage who's a marathon runner, and I said to her, now play flexibility and best workout before you go and run your 10Ks, and then play releasing muscle tension. She didn't listen, and she played all three, and she rang me up and she said, I just ran like two fat already. I said, I bet you played releasing muscle tension, didn't you?
You studied kinesiology, haven't you?
But the athlete sports bag, we've actually, we're sponsoring the website's in process. My website builder's kind of offline at the moment. We're actually sponsoring some featured athletes, so we're having some fantastic results with people. Most of my work's based on cell memory, Rick, so I deal with the memory in every cell of the body, basically. So that the sounds ask the body to release whatever it's holding on to. So I use the same thing for moving earthbound energies and clearing houses and stuff.
Yeah, it's a shame that you.
So it's all fun.
Yeah, it's a shame that you're awesome, no longer on the coast or you
on the mountain.
Yeah, would it be nice for
you on the mountain
to get together?
Yeah.
Oh well, yep.
Yeah. Oh well, yep. At some stage, if you know, if I've got anything you'd like to have a trial with or play with, Rick, let me know.
Do you have
You know, it's all about sharing knowledge and information, isn't it?
Definitely, yeah. It's actually funny you mentioned channeling earlier. It's my first once I got reawoken or unveiled or whatever they want to call it. My first big experience was a huge channeling process.
Really cool.
It was really cool. We had an investigation, and
we were sitting at a dining table.
I was sitting opposite the client. Her partner was sitting to the right, my right, and one of the psychics that's no longer with us anymore, but was with me initially, is to my left, and I just felt this energy behind me, and I looked at Chris and I said, "There's somebody behind me, isn't there?" And he said, "Yeah, there is."
And he said,
"You're alright." I said, "Yeah, I'm fine. I can just feel it behind me." And then he started asking the client a few questions because I didn't tell him anything about the case at all. And
all of a sudden, I started feeling my spine.
All of a sudden, I started feeling my spine just went icy cold and tingly.
And it stayed that way.
And it stayed that way. And then Chris had asked, can't even think of a name now. He'd asked the client a question. And I slowly started getting different sensations. One was my whole body went icy cold and tingly for a couple of seconds, and then back to just the spine. And then the other one, I don't know how to describe it apart from. It was just like an inert feeling. It was enough of a change to know it was a change. And then I started working out slowly that the whole body tingle was whenever she responded yes, and the inert feeling was when she responded no.
And
I started sort of a couple of times I was doing the whole body physical body shiver because it was so cold. And Chris kept looking at me a few times. He's like, "You're right, dude." I'm like, "Yeah, I'm fine, mate. I'm fine." Then once I really worked out, definitely the yes and no responses. I asked Lorraine. I asked her to start asking herself yes or no questions.
So she did. She started asking yes.
And we went for probably a good 45 minutes doing different questions. And it turned out it was her twin sister.
She turns out that
I didn't even know that at this stage, but she was obviously one of two twins. And the doctors didn't know that mum was pregnant with twins at the time. She was 52 at the time. She'd have to be 55 or 56 now. But
when they did the one and only
ultrasound back then, they think that they must have been chest to chest, the two babies, and they only picked up on the one heartbeat. So Lorraine obviously came out first, not knowing that there was a second child in there. They moved on doing whatever they were doing, and the second one died inside the womb and came out later.
But they didn't even have a name picked out for her.
Obviously, not knowing that she was there. But she wanted Lorraine to know that she'd been with her her whole life, and one of the things Lorraine was really worried about is the constant feeling of cold tingles around her. But she wanted her to know that it was just her giving her a hug. And she was just feeling her energy. Wanted to let mum and dad know that she didn't blame them, that she was happy, she was looking over them as well.
A few other bits and pieces she wanted to get through to different family members.
Then Lorraine sort of said, is there anything else? And I got another yes response. And then we started going through three different things. No, 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 no. Is it a health issue? Yes.
So basically, she couldn't give her much information apart from the fact that she had to go and get checked out.
You look at Lorraine, she was
52. And you look at Lorraine, she was 52, but fit as a fiddle. She's gym downstairs. She ate the right things, like complete opposite to me, basically. She looked after herself, and you just would not think that she, for a second, would have anything health-related wrong with her. Didn't smoke, didn't drink. All of that sort of stuff. So she heeded the advice, went on Monday to go and get some tests done.
Went back on the results.
Went back on the Wednesday to get the results. And the doctor's going through, as I expected, nothing wrong there, nothing wrong there, nothing wrong there. Hang on a minute, I don't remember running that report. I've gone and looked up the, running that test, sorry. Gone and looked up the thing on the computer. Oh, yeah, I did. I don't normally do that for this sort of thing.
Turned out she had
ovarian cancer.
Basically,
the results of that test, the doctor sent her for more tests and then sent her to a specialist. The specialist saw her that Friday.
Got all the results
and all that sort of stuff, and basically said to her, if you had to come to us a month later, you would have been told you've got 6 months to live with no chance of any success. They had her in surgery the following Wednesday, removed both her ovaries, and quite literally saved a life.
It's amazing what comes through, isn't it?
For me, it freaked me out. It was really, I was loving the experience, but it's sort of being my first psychic experience, really. It was pretty full on.
For me, Rick, I've probably been talking to dead people since I was about three. So it's been a lifelong situation, but I actually see them, and they'll come and chat to me. It's like having a conversation with you guys.
Yes.
And my mother was horrified.
Strange child.
She had this strange child. And my family background, a bit like Sharon Ann's, I'm Scots Irish Welsh Manx. So I was born in the UK, and the Welsh and the Manx were my father's side of the family, and my grandmother was Welsh and psychic, and my grandfather's family was Spanish gypsies originally who settled in the Isle of Man. And then the Scots and Irish on the other side. So, you know, I was just this strange child all of my life, and it just never went away. And eventually I learned to shut up about it because I was always getting sent to my room. You know, go to your room or don't eat biscuits before you go to bed if you're going to have nightmares and stuff like that. So my children still do cross fingers. You know, mum does spooky stuff. If you ask them what I did, they've got what I do, they've got no idea. Just mum does stuff. And they're not interested. Which I find quite fascinating. So, you know, other people go, oh, wow, Sheila's amazing, isn't she? And they go, oh, okay. Keeps you humble.
It does, yeah. I believe everybody's born with a psychic gift. Like the amount of times, you know, like you just mentioned then, you know, the amount of times you hear parents say, oh, you know, little Johnny or little Susie's up in their room playing with their imaginary friends.
Imaginary friends, yeah.
They're not. They're interacting with spirit. Anywhere from age three, sometimes well into the teens, they make a subconscious decision to either embrace it or block it out. I remember a few experiences when I was a kid, probably the main two that stick out is whenever I'd leave Nana and Granddad's house and walk out to the car, I'd look up the street, up the hill, up the street, and I'd see it's like the black panther on the Energizer batteries, the big black cat, but it was taller than the houses, and it would come around the corner and start heading down towards me, and then I'd run over to Mum, Dad, Nana, Granddad, whoever was there, and grab hold of them and tell them, you know, the big cat was coming for me again, and they'd come out with me and nothing would be there.
I never seemed aggressive thinking back on it now, but it freaked me out as a kid, of course.
And then must have been about four, woke up one night, it was raining, thunder, pouring lightning, thunder.
I've actually got to go and prove two assignments for my kids before they go to bed. Sorry about this. So I'll leave you to chatting, and I'll be in touch, Rick, with you about next month. Sure. And Sheila, look after yourself, sure. Sweetie.
I will, thank you, my dear.
And I'll talk
I will, thank you, my dear.
Okay, thanks. Bye. Again, Rick.
Bye now.
Bye.
Take care, Sharon.